Hey everyone, before we get started, this week's episode of Cartoon Conspiracy will be diving pretty heavily into the topic of suicide, so with that in mind, viewer discretion is advised. Thanks for understanding. Well, we've been taking a look at Rick and Morty quite a bit, haven't we? But I mean, we have to. The new season just ended, so we gotta get all of our discussion out there before the inevitable torrential downpour of shitposting that's going to come with this season break. But seriously, with the end of season 3, we're all left wondering, what's next for Rick and company? Rick's now been relegated to the lowest status member of the family, even below Jerry, so we might as well just stick Rick in his own personal hell. But even for someone with as many demons as Rick, this might just be the last straw for him. And one theory suggests that Rick has actually been planning to end it all ever since the show first premiered. I'm Jacob with Channel Frederator, and today we're going to stumble into this incredibly dark theory and try to figure out once and for all, has Rick been building his very own suicide helmet? Yes, I am aware of how weird that last thing I just said was. Suicide helmet? How does that even work? Helmets are supposed to protect your head. Well, strap in, because this one gets pretty gruesome. So throughout the series, we've been treated to several views of Rick's garage, full of his unique gadgets and machinery. But there's one piece of equipment in his garage that's appeared more than a few times. This weird-looking helmet thing that looks like a colander with a few boppet appendages sticking out of it. The show has even times shown Rick tinkering with it, most notably at the beginning of Vindicators 3, so it's not like this is some sort of stock asset that the animators use. There's thought put into this helmet, with its first appearance being in the very second episode of the series. At first glance, many people have pointed out that this helmet is probably a throwback to Doc Brown's brainwave analyzer from the Back to the Future films, which makes sense because Rick was initially based on Doc Brown. But what kind of fan theory is that? That's not nearly dark enough. We have to go deeper. This theory gained traction recently because people started to notice a similarity in design between Rick's helmet and another helmet with strange protrusions that's been making its rounds on the internet lately. As the story goes, the guy who originally posted these photos had a brother-in-law who shadowed a coroner. And during this time, the coroner shared with the brother-in-law the most disturbing thing he's ever seen. Apparently, back in the 60s or 70s, there was a young man who constructed a helmet that was designed to fire 8 shotgun shells into his head simultaneously. And this was made possible by a complex trigger mechanism that the suicidal man designed himself in an amazing show of engineering prowess. And while the credibility of the story is kinda shaky since it's been through the internet machine and basically turned into an urban legend, these photos have endured all that. And this helmet's design bears a lot of similarities to the helmet that we see in Rick's garage. It even has similar appendages sticking out of the top of the helmet. So could Rick be designing his very own version of this so-called suicide helmet? Meticulously crafting a way to end it all in the Rickest way imaginable by engineering the means himself? I mean, it's no secret that Rick has a bit of a death wish. Assuming that the Rick we follow throughout the show is the same one, just based on his adventures, Rick has had ample opportunity to die pretty much anytime he wants. But of course, so far, he's never actually taken that opportunity. But this is Rick that we're talking about, and Rick seems like the kind of guy who believes that nobody, not even other versions of himself, gets to kill him but him. Philosopher Thomas Zass wrote on the topic of suicide that it is the ultimate freedom of man. It's the ultimate way for someone to declare ownership of themselves. And for someone like Rick, who is more than aware that infinite versions of himself not only exist, but try to govern his life, the act of suicide would serve as the ultimate middle finger to all of those other Ricks who believe they have any control over him. It would become his one final act of self-destructive rebellion that Rick has become so synonymous with. And pushing all of that aside, there's one more piece of evidence that's always brought up when talking about Rick's death wish. Rick never wears a seatbelt on his ship while Morty is always strapped in. And since this show is very careful with its details and little to nothing is an accident, this is a very interesting detail to consistently animate. And that's pretty much the suicide helmet theory. And while it's incredibly dark and gruesome to imagine that Rick has been secretly planning to kill himself at any moment throughout the entire run of the series, is there anything that could convince us otherwise? Ugh, okay. We got a lot to cover here. First, let's take a look at the helmet's basic design. The helmet doesn't just cover the eyes, it provides lenses so that the wearer can see what they're doing. But given the possible nature of the helmet, wouldn't it make more sense for the helmet to have a consistent shape all the way around just to mitigate any sort of mess that might happen? I mean, not to nitpick someone's suicide for technical reasons, but for something so calculated, if this helmet's purpose is what this theory says it is, What's the benefit of having an eyepiece there? Next, just because the helmet has made multiple appearances in the show, that doesn't actually guarantee anything. Case in point, the almost obnoxiously labeled time travel stuff box that has appeared not just in the show on multiple occasions, but also in the VR game Rick and Morty Virtual Rickality. This box is a constant in Rick's garage, but the show has gone out of its way on multiple occasions to reference that they will never do anything relating to time travel. It's actually a pretty funny visual representation of all time travel plots being shelved. But unless the staff does start to do time travel plots, it seems like this box on the shelf is not some sort of Chekhov's gun waiting to go off. And because of that, we can't guarantee the eventual use of Rick's helmet either. But okay, I'll admit that that's not exactly the strongest point. After all, the time travel box is more of a joke, and we've never seen Rick interact with it in the same way that we've seen him interact with this helmet. So, let's examine Rick's death wish a little more closely. While Zaz's writings on suicide can be thought-provoking, the philosophy can just as easily be turned around. Rick lives in a world where the pursuit of meaning in the absence of any sort of higher power is, well, absurd. Say it with me now. Nobody exists on purpose, nobody belongs anywhere, everybody's gonna die. Come watch TV. And French absurdist philosopher Albert Camus wrote pretty much the opposite of Zaz, saying that suicide was ultimately the rejection of freedom, and that to flee from the chaotic world is not the way out. And instead, one must grab life by its absurdly large balls and just see how long they can hang on. That may or may not be a direct quote from him, I may have paraphrased that last part. But depending on which episode you're watching, this philosophy could totally apply to Rick. So his outlook isn't as clear-cut as it might seem. His philosophy, like many others, is complex and contradictory in a lot of areas. And despite all waxing philosophical, there's one more thing here that relates a bit more directly to the suicide helmet theory. We've already seen Rick try to kill himself in one of the most emotional episode endings of the entire series. And what's more, no suicide helmet in sight. Would this not be the time for it to be visible more than any other time, if nothing else for the sake of symbolism? Okay, so moving right along, I want to talk about the seatbelt. Many theorists point to this as some sort of smoking gun that proves that Rick secretly wants to die. Why else would he do something so reckless despite only needing to take 5 seconds to make his journey so much safer? It's a valid question, but I think I have something a bit more convincing than just immediately assuming that Rick doesn't care if he lives or dies. And what else would it be but the real world? First off, I'll admit that yes, Rick doesn't wear his seatbelt, that much is obvious. But you know who else doesn't wear their seatbelt? My grandparents, and probably yours too. Most of us probably think it's unfathomable and reckless to drive without a seatbelt, which is good because it is, but the thing to keep in mind is that most of us were probably born in the late 80s or the 90s or the 2000s. We grew up with seatbelt laws, but older generations like Rick's just didn't. Seatbelts didn't become mandatory for American car manufacturers until the 1960s, and wearing a seatbelt wasn't made mandatory by law in America until New York passed the first legislation in 1984, which led to every other state passing similar laws, with Maine being the last state to enact mandatory seatbelt legislation on December 26th of 1995. Except New Hampshire, which is the only state to have still not passed any legislation forcing adults to wear seatbelts. What are you guys doing over there? I mean, I know your state motto is live free or die, but you don't have to be so damn literal about it. And all right, I'm just gonna throw a couple more numbers at you real quick. According to the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, in 2013, American seatbelt usage was at 87%. Pretty good, right? Now, take a guess as to what that number was a little over 30 years ago when that first law in New York was passed. Got your guess? Okay, well, I obviously can't predict what exactly your guess was. Was it 27? Well, to all of those who said 27, and also most of the rest of you, you're wrong. It was lower. Way lower. It was only a measly 14%. And to bring this back to Rick and Morty, we know that A, Rick is 70, and B, the Smiths live in Washington State. So if the show takes place in the same time as our world, then that would mean that Rick was 39 years old when these laws were first enacted in Washington in 1986. So combining the facts that Rick didn't grow up with seatbelt laws, and the fact that Rick isn't the kind of person to let any government tell him what to do, him not wearing a seatbelt seems a lot more like a grandpa thing and not a suicidal thing. The reason his ship has seatbelts in the first place was more likely to accommodate Morty than anything else. And finally, let's come back to this idea that Rick's suicide helmet is actually a throwback to this internet story about the supposed real-life suicide helmet. Rick and Morty, more than any other show, seems to have its finger on the pulse of what's popular, although these days it seems to be setting internet trends rather than referencing them. In any case, thanks to some backwards Google engineering, we found that the suicide helmet story most likely originated on an Imgur thread on November 22nd of 2014, which of course lines up perfectly with the helmet's first appearance on the show on December 9th of 2013. Huh. Turns out Rick and Morty's helmet actually came a year before the real-life suicide helmet story, which would make it kinda difficult for the show to reference, especially since, you know, it had to go through the animation pipeline even before it was on TV. The only way for this theory to still be true would be if the writers sort of retroactively decided that Rick's helmet is now a suicide helmet, or if the staff somehow already knew about this helmet before its rise to prominence on the internet. But even given the incredibly small chance that that is the case, it doesn't really deal with any of our previous counterarguments, which have taken a lot of wind out of the sails of this theory. When examining the idea of Rick's suicide helmet closely, pretty much every aspect of it falls apart rather quickly. This just seems like one of those theories that just goes the extra mile to be dark for the sake of being dark. Which is funny, because Rick and Morty is plenty dark already. I mean, I can't deny that Rick is at least a bit suicidal, but some pieces of evidence that this theory points to are just a little bit too much of a stretch for my tastes. I know I bring up Occam's razor a lot, but in the case of this helmet, the simplest answer probably is the correct one, and it is just a reference to Rick's original Back to the Future inspiration. But even though the arguments against this theory are pretty overwhelming, I'm not going to rate it zero because, on the off chance that the writers do decide to go in this direction, I'm gonna look like a complete idiot. So with that in mind, I'm going to rate the conspiracy of Rick's suicide helmet 0.5 boxes of time travel stuff out of 5. But what do you think? Do you think that Rick has secretly been working on a suicide helmet throughout the duration of the show? Do you think that the helmet might serve some other story purpose? And how emotionally struck were you by the end of the episode Autoerotic Assimilation? Because I can tell you, it just wrecked me for like a good week or so. Be sure to let us know your thoughts in the comments, and also, while you're down there, be sure to let us know of any conspiracies you'd like us to take a look at later on. Until then, be sure to like this video, subscribe to Channel Frederator if this is your first time here, and don't forget to click that little bell icon next to the subscribe button to become part of our notification squad. Because remember, Frederator loves you.